Now, in the earlier, first session, we talked about the supernatural world via the Old Testament. We talked about really two things, about three, you know, mostly two, three or third thing. The three things we talked about were the divine council idea, and then we talked about the division of the nations, okay, among, you know, allotting them to the sons of God and vice versa. This whole idea of cosmic geography. And then toward the end, we talked about what was sort of the original vision in biblical theology in Eden. And again, that was to have, you know, heaven come to earth, God have one unified family, human family with his divine family, the divine sons of God, working together, enjoying God's presence together, participating in the way God runs things together. And it's no coincidence that that vision is really behind the way the global Eden in the book, at the end of the book of Revelation, is described. So we'll eventually wind up there. But some of these concepts, especially the whole idea of the gods of the nations and cosmic geography, is where I want to focus in this particular session with the New Testament, because this, that sort of bleeds into a number of passages. And again, I only have a little bit of time, so I'm just going to pick out a few things to think about. Again, that you'd run into in the New Testament, but these things are framed by certain things in the Old Testament. So cosmic geography, the idea of reclaiming the nations that were disinherited by God at Babel, is a really significant theme in biblical theology in both Testaments. Now, this is arguably one of the most familiar passages in the New Testament. Okay, if you've been to church for any amount of time, you're going to hear sermons on Pentecost. So what could be more familiar? What could be simpler? Well, a whole lot of things. What I want to show you is how Pentecost and the event of Pentecost ties in to the division, the disinheritance of the nations back at Babel. And of course, Pentecost is the beginning of the solution to reclaiming the nations. So here's again what a person in the first century would have been thinking. So you get to Acts 2, the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as of fire appeared. Now you'll notice my little thing's not working here. Divided is in blue, the column is in blue, and what I want you to see is the Greek word behind the word divided is something that you can pronounce diamerizo. Just hold on to that. Divided tongues as of fire. Diamerizo. Well, guess where that word shows up in the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament. In other words, when Luke wrote Acts, he's writing in Greek, he's writing to Theophilus, his friend. He's writing in Greek, and he's using the Septuagint along the way. Guess where it shows up? It shows up in Deuteronomy 32:8. Remember that verse? When the Most High divided up the nations, he divided them up according to the number of the sons of God. Again, to the person reading in Greek or hearing it in Greek, who knew his Old Testament well, that's going to be a red flag. That's going to be something, okay, you use that term, I remember that term when you're reading back in my Old Testament. So that's going to be, again, an alert to the person reading Acts 2 or listening. He keeps going. Now they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered. Right here, now we're working again. Bewildered, Greek term is sunkeo. Okay. Where does that word show up in the Septuagint? Lo and behold, it's in Genesis 11. What's in Genesis 11? The Tower of Babel story. They're confused. The languages are confused. It's the same Greek word. So Luke is putting little hooks into Genesis 11, the Babel story, and Deuteronomy 32, 8, 9, the Babel story. He's doing that deliberately. He's telegraphing something. He wants to alert readers to what he's going to be describing. We get the list of nations in Acts chapter 2. Now, this is a bit of a confusing graphic without the legend, but basically the ones in red caps are the place names in Acts 2. If you remember the story, we'll just recap it here. Pentecost is happening. You get Jewish people from all over the known world coming to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast, celebrate the events of Pentecost. They're there in those other nations scattered around the Mediterranean in part because of the exile. Okay, because they had been scattered for centuries all over the ancient world. But now they're coming back to celebrate this feast. And the Spirit of God, this is going to be the fulfillment of the passages in Ezekiel 36 and 37, the New Covenant language in Jeremiah 33. This is going to be where it all happens. And the disciples, after, again, the crucifixion and the resurrection, were told to gather in this upper room and wait for the coming of the Spirit. Again, you know the story of Pentecost. The Spirit comes and they are enabled to speak with other languages, and they go out and they start preaching. What? About Jesus. Crucifixion, resurrection, the whole bit. And thousands of people, thousands of Jews from these places embrace the idea that Jesus was the Messiah, they believe, and now they're going to go back to these places, these nations. And they're essentially little implants. They're infiltrators. They are on a new team, and they're going to infiltrate this turf of the nations who, in the Old Testament worldview, are under dominion of other gods. And certainly in the first century, all these places worship multiple gods. And they become tools of the Spirit to start spreading the kingdom of God, to kickstart it again, and to begin the process of extracting believers, followers of Jesus, those who are loyal to the God of Israel, embodied in Christ, to reform and reconstitute and spread this thing we know in biblical theology as the kingdom of God. This is where it begins, in terms of the Spirit's activity. Now, when you go through, we'll come back to the list of nations in Acts 2, because I want you to notice something. In fact, I could introduce the idea right here. If you read the list as it's given in Acts chapter 2, the list begins over here, okay, to the right, on the east side. The names move from east to west. They hit the water, of course, it branches into upper and lower portions, but it moves from east to west, and its farthermost, its westernmost point is Italy. The messaging behind this is that where, again, these are all Jews, where do you have the most Jews because of the exile? You have them over here, because this is where they were held in exile. You got Babylon over here, Persia, remember the book of Esther, all this kind of stuff. Many of them never come back to the Holy Land. They stay in, you know, Mesopotamia, Persia. So the list begins there. God saying, I'm going to reclaim my people from out of the nations, and then I'm going to send them back to start reclaiming the nations themselves. And we move east to west. Why? Okay, we'll get there in a second. When you move beyond Acts 2, look at some of the stuff that happens in Acts. In Acts 8, we have Samaria mentioned. Why is it important to mention Samaria in this process of God reclaiming Jewish people, reclaiming the tribes? to use them as tools to reclaim the nations themselves, to bless the nations through the descendants of Abraham. Why would we mention Samaria? Samaria is not in the list in the Pentecost list, Acts chapter 2. Luke wants to make sure that we know that Samaria wasn't missed. Because Samaria is important. It is the headquarters in the Old Testament of the northern kingdom of Israel. It's where the 10 tribes went. That was their kingdom. They apostatized first. The messaging is very simple. I'm collecting them back. They're not going to be missed. It's not just the two tribes in the south. I'm hitting Samaria too. Phoenicia gets mentioned. Why is that important? Because Phoenicia was within the allotted land boundaries of the promised land. These are mine. God is taking care of his turf first, and then he's going to use the converts to go get the other nations. This is a deliberate strategy. It's a deliberate telegraphing of what God is up to in these lists. Ethiopia, the eunuch. Why would we bother mentioning the Ethiopian eunuch? Again, because these places have significance in the Old Testament. In this case, it's going to be an area that is included in the Table of Nations from Genesis 10, but doesn't get mentioned in Acts 2. The messaging, again, is the same. We didn't miss that one. You go through Acts, and there are things that happen in Acts at specific places, again, to telegraph the idea that God's not missing any of it. He's not neglecting anybody. He's not sort of casting somebody off to the side. He's getting every last inch of what is his, and he's going to reclaim all the nations that he disinherited. You get to Acts 9, that's Paul's conversion. Okay, Paul, of course, is going to view himself as, because he is, the apostle to the Gentiles. Why does he go to Damascus? I mean, why do we have Damascus in here? Why is there a church in Damascus? Luke could have mentioned churches anywhere. Well, what's with Damascus? Remember God's promise to Abraham when he split up from Lot? He says, I'll let Lot go. Let him choose the land that he wants. Because every place your foot treads, that's the land I'll give to you. When Abraham has to rescue Lot, and he pursues, again, the people that kidnapped him, guess where they stop? Damascus. He finally catches them in Damascus, rescues Lot. Abraham's foot landed in Damascus because he was rescuing Lot. Again, if you know your Old Testament, the messaging is simple. That's Abraham's turf too. And it falls within, again, certain boundary designations that are given in the Old Testament for the Promised Land. None of this is accidental. That's what I'm trying to tell you. None of this is accidental. These are not throwaway place names. They are designed to telegraph ideas. We'll get to Paul in Spain in a moment. Cornelius, the first Gentile, 10. You know, Acts 10, we'll go back here. This is the turning point. After all the stuff that's associated with the Promised Land and the 12 tribes are included in the discussion, then we shift to Cornelius, the first Gentile convert. Now the messaging changes. It's not just about the 12 tribes anymore. It's about all of them. So all those Jews at Pentecost, in all those nations that were disinherited, they actually have a job to do. They're not just supposed to go back and tell everybody in their synagogue. They're going to go back and spread the gospel to everybody. Because the nations actually rightfully belong to Yahweh. He is the one that surrendered them, disinherited them by his own decision. They were not taken from him. He abandoned them as punishment. And now it's time to reverse course and bring them back. Now, Paul has this thing about Spain. This is, you know, toward, you know, the latter part of Paul's life as we know it. In Acts 20, Paul says, Now, behold, I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. So Paul's like, I need to go to Jerusalem because the Spirit of God wants me to go there, and he's telling me it's going to be bad. Something bad's going to happen. But I know I'm supposed to go. Acts 21, having sought out the disciples, you know, this is their on their way to Jerusalem, we stayed there for 7 days, and through the Spirit, they were telling Paul not to go to Jerusalem. It's because the Spirit, apparently, is telling these other disciples that something bad's going to happen to Paul when he gets to Jerusalem. So they're like, don't go. And Paul's like, well, I know that already, because the Spirit told me too. But I'm supposed to go there. I know I need to go there. While we were staying there for many days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea, and coming to us, he took Paul's belt, bound his own feet and hands, and said, thus says the Holy Spirit, this is how the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him to the hands of the Gentiles. And Paul says, yeah, I know that. Paul says, I'm willing for that to happen. I'm willing to die. I just know I'm supposed to go. The Spirit's told me the same thing. I appreciate your concern, but we're going. Now, after these events, Paul resolved in the Spirit to pass through Macedonia and Achaia, go to Jerusalem, saying, after I've been there, I must also see Rome. See, Paul not only knows he's supposed to go to Jerusalem, he believes that after Jerusalem, he's going to go to Rome. He's not saying here, I know what's going to happen. I'm going to get arrested. I'm going to cause a riot. I'm going to be put on trial again. And I'm going to have to make all these appeals, and then I'm finally going to appeal to Caesar, and I'm going to get to Rome. He doesn't know that, but he has a sense that he's supposed to go to Jerusalem, and he's going to go to Rome too. And that's good news for Paul. Why? Because it continues the westerly advance of the gospel. Because Paul has another destination in mind that he is quite eager to see. He writes to the Romans. Okay, he's on the ship, you know, going to see the Romans. He's going to Rome. He appealed to Caesar. He's under arrest. He's never met them before, so he writes the letter of Romans, and he says to them in chapter 15, and thus I make it my ambition to preach the gospel, not where Christ has already been named, lest I build on someone else's foundation. But now, since I no longer have any room for work in these regions, and he's concerned about the regions that haven't been worked in, and since I have longed for many years to come to you, I hope to see you in passing as I go to Spain. When therefore I have completed this and have delivered it to them what has been collected, I will leave for Spain by way of you. He said, well, big deal. Maybe Paul just wanted a nice vacation. He got nice beaches in Spain. You know, he's tired, you know, good time there, he's celebrating. Like, man, I've never been there. No. Why is Paul urgently talking about getting to Spain? Hey, I love you Roman people. I can't wait to meet you guys. But I just want to let you know I'm not going to be there long. But after we talk with you a little, I'm going to Spain. What's the big deal? You'll notice in the Acts list, again, if you read the list, we've got an east to west direction. All of these places, in all this territory, coincides with the table of nations. This is the same, these are the same land masses, okay, even up here in the Black Sea, these are the same land masses that you would find the nations listed in Genesis 10 occupying that space. And the idea is this is the known world at the time. The gospel is going to spread through all these nations that Yahweh disinherited in Genesis 10. But we have a problem. You see, the book of Acts ends here with Paul in Rome. You know, church historians agree that Paul was released, you know, lived for a few more years, was rearrested, and eventually beheaded in Rome. We know where Paul wanted to go. He wanted to go to Spain. Church tradition, the Bible doesn't say that he got there, but church tradition says there's a strong, again, set of circumstantial evidence that he got there. But why did he care? Because there was one place in the table of nations that hadn't heard the gospel yet. Tarshish. That's Spain. Paul had it in his head that, you know, I'm the apostle to the Gentiles. I am the guy. You know, I am the figure God is using. You know, from the very day that the Lord knocked him off his horse at Damascus and said, get off your butt, go to Damascus, go to this guy's, I have chosen you. You are the apostle to the Gentiles. Paul knows his Old Testament really well. Isaiah 66 mentions a lot of these nations and the ones that are in Acts, and it includes Tarshish as well. Paul believes that his job as the apostle of the Gentiles is not completed until he lands in Spain, because that is the last place, the last nation that has to be reclaimed that was disinherited. I think he was sort of obsessed by it. Because I also think that Paul had a sense that he wasn't going to die in Rome. He's not going to die. I'm not going to die until I get to Spain, because that's the job. That's the job. That's the job God hired me, really recruited me for, and he's not going to let me down. I'm not going to let him down. We're going to get there, because Paul talked about this with a phrase that occurs a few times in the New Testament called the fullness of the Gentiles. You look up that phrase, the fullness of the Gentiles. In Paul's mind, this was the key to the Lord's return. The Lord is not going to return until all of these nations have been brought into submission, till he has extracted all of his people from every one of them, till he exerts dominion over every one of them. And I have to get to Spain to pull that off. I mean, I just have to do it, because this is my job. We read these things in the New Testament, and again, I know it's boring. It's a list of place names. These places have a history. Okay, they're part of a construct, again, this whole cosmic geographical thing. There are reasons why the prophets talk about the nations that were disinherited. It's because of this, because they need to be brought back. And there's a reason the apostles, namely Paul, talks about the fullness of the Gentiles has to be brought in before the Lord will return. Now, we know that the world's a lot bigger than this. And of course, God knew that. But the biblical writers are expressing these ideas in the language that they had, the knowledge they knew. This was their world. The messaging is that all the nations of the world are owned by Yahweh. They need to be brought into his kingdom. And we just have to do that job. This is why we're here. Another thing, I'm just pulling things topically from the book. There's a whole lot more to this. There's a whole lot more to lots of things. That's what the book's for. Look at Paul's vocabulary. Now, Paul does use the word demon a few times. But when Paul talks about the forces of darkness, these are the terms he uses. Rulers, principalities, powers, authorities, powers, dunamis, dominions, lords, thrones, world rulers. Guess what they all have in common? They are all outside the Greek New Testament and within the New Testament. They are all terms of geographical rulership. You say, well, why is that significant? Because according to the Deuteronomy 32 worldview, the supernatural worldview of the Old Testament, all the nations are under the dominion of other gods, who have become corrupt and are now hostile to Yahweh. We have a spiritual war on our hands. We're not dealing with demons. They're flunkies. If you know what, I don't know if we'll get into what a demon was in Second Temple Judaism, but they ain't these guys. They are lower in the hierarchy. Paul's saying, we have a problem here. People are in bondage to other gods, either willingly or unwillingly, and they have to be released because God wants his turn. And this is our job. And this is the biblical basis for what I think flippantly call spiritual warfare in, today's parlance. But the vocabulary is just very obvious. Another topic, already but not yet. And we talked about the image, okay? The idea of participatory governance, representing God, heaven meeting earth, all that sort of stuff. Well, to reclaim the vision in the New Testament, just again, look at some of the vocabulary. Christians are referred to as sons and daughters of God. Okay, but as many as received him, to them he gave the authority to be called the sons of God. The language is not accidental. Remember the little triangle thing about the three-tier divine council, the sons of God in the middle tier, they're God's household. They have high authority over the angels. The sons of God initially ruled the nations, according to Deuteronomy 32:8-9. They became corrupt. Guess what? They're going to lose their jobs. They're going to be replaced. Guess by who? By Christians. Believers are the reconstituted council. And there are a number of passages that reflect this thinking. Displacing the fallen gods. Ruling over the nations under the authority of God, Jesus. And a global evil. Again, sons and daughters of God, this is language we run into in any Bible study, but it has a context. That's the point. It has a history. It has a conceptual heritage that we just don't think about. But it's important to really understand, hey, Christian, do you really know who you are? Already, but not yet. In all this language, John 1:12, 1 John 3, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. And then John says, and that's what we are. Then he goes on. I love the little throwaway phrase, and that's what we are. Like he just has to toss it in there. Galatians 3, or Romans 8, the creation, you know, travails awaiting for, you know, awaiting the revealing of the sons of God. And it's an eschatological vision. 2 Peter 1:4, you've been made partakers of the divine nature. Hebrews 2 is a really cool passage. I'm going to click out to that one. Let me close your linear view. Now this is Hebrews 2. I'll make it actually a little smaller. Get a little bit more on here. Okay, book of Hebrews, first chapter is, you know, to which of the angels did God ever say this and that? You know, because Christ is superior to the angels. Well, the reason Christ is superior to the angels is because he's identified with Yahweh and as Yahweh in flesh. Okay? So you get to Hebrews 2, and the writer says, now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him, but we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels. He's quoting the psalm there that says, you know, created lower than the Elohim. Namely, Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. This is why, that is why, I mean, look at the next line. That is why Jesus, you know, he is not ashamed to call them us, brothers, saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers. He's going to, you know, it's this heavenly picture again. I'm going to tell your name, you know, God's name, to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. Congregation, that's a nice translation. You know how else you can translate that? Council. Jesus is going to present God to us in the council, and of course, us to the council, because we are the ones that he was given. priest, high priest in prayer of John 17, I have kept them by your name. Why? Because it's our destiny to be the sons of God. And these little threads are not, you know, just sort of there. They're there for a reason. Revelation 2. Jesus is speaking, nevertheless, hold fast to what you have until I come. And the one who conquers, you know, to him that overcomes, and who keeps my works until the end, I will give him authority over the nations. Well, who has it now? The fallen gods. Who's losing it now? The fallen gods. Every person, you know, who enters the kingdom of God is a loss for the powers of darkness. Their territory shrinks every day, little by little. To him that overcomes, when we get to the end, I will put him over the nations. He will shepherd them. Okay, the person I hand over authority to the nations, you will shepherd them with an iron rod. He will break them in pieces like jars made of clay. Do you realize what this is? He's quoting Psalm 2, which is a messianic psalm. He's attributing Psalm 2, messianic rule, to believers, to Christians. This is Jesus talking. You're going to have the authority that I have. I'm going to share it with you. To him that overcomes, I will set over the nations. I will give him the morning star. Now, the morning star is another reference to divine royalty. Revelation, you know, here we have a little bit, Revelation 2:28. Numbers 24:17, the star, you know, will rise from Jacob. Let's hurry up here a little bit. Again, I am the root and descendant of David, the bright morning star. Revelation 3, the one who conquers, I will grant him, and this is you, to sit down with me on my throne, as I also have conquered and have sat down with my Father on his throne. This is why Paul says, don't you know that the saints, the holy ones, believers, will judge the world? And if the world is to be judged by you, are you incompetent to try trivial cases? Don't you know that we are to judge angels? Paul's like, don't you get this? Why are you taking each other to court? Don't you get it? Apparently they didn't. It's the Corinthian church. They didn't get it much. Again, these are just snippets of New Testament cosmic geography. We can, you know, I'll just verbally, we have a couple minutes here. Jesus. Two episodes of Jesus' life, again, are very illustrative of why, again, thinking in supernatural cosmic geographical terms in the, you know, when you get to the New Testament, framing it in the Old Testament is important, you know, with an eye toward this kind of content. You know, Jesus goes to Caesarea Philippi. This is the famous scene where, you know, he asks, you know, Peter, who do men say that I am? And, you know, well, some say this, some say that. And who do you say I am? You know, thou art Christ. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he's like, yep. You know, this isn't something that you got because you're so smart. It's been revealed to you. He said, thou art Peter. And upon this rock, I will build my church. Now, of course, Roman Catholicism, you know, teaches that the rock is Peter. Protestants teach, no, we can't do that. We can't say that. The Catholics must be wrong. So the rock is the church for believers. I don't believe either of those is correct. I think the rock is where he's standing when he says it. Where is he standing? Where's Caesarea Philippi? It's at the foot of Mount Hermon, which is at the northern end of Bashan. In New Testament times, this was a cult center to Pan, called Panias or Banias, depending on the phonetics. In the Old Testament, it was a cult center to Baal at Dan, a few miles away. But the whole area was viewed as a stronghold of Baal in the Old Testament. In Canaanite literature, there are two cities in this region that are mentioned, Ashtaroth and Edrei. They're also mentioned in the Old Testament. They are the place where the Rephaim live. in Ugaritic texts, these two places are actually called the gateway to the netherworld, the gates of hell. What Jesus is saying is, look, I am the Christ. I am the Son of God. And upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not be able to withstand it. I'm going to make what you guys think is Satan's realm, you know, the netherworld here. You know, we're standing at the gates of the netherworld. This is how you think about it. I'm going to make that place his tomb before it's all said and done. Which is really audacious. What do they do after Jesus says this? They go 3 days to the mountain. Well, there's only one mountain there. It's Mount Hermon, which in Second Temple literature had all sorts of associations. Mount Hermon was the place where the Watchers, the sons of God from Genesis 6, descended and made their pact to violate the boundaries between heaven and earth with human women. Hermon is related to Harem, which is the word for holy war, to devote to destruction in the conquest accounts of Joshua and Moses. Again, none of this is accidental. So Jesus goes to Mount Hermon, a little ways up in the mountain. What happens there 3 days after the Thou art Peter passage? It's the transfiguration. So he goes to like ground zero in their thinking for the bad place, and he's transfigured. I'm here. What are you going to do about it? I believe that he baits powers of darkness. I think this is a poke in the eye. Because after the transfiguration is done, then what do we learn? The gospel's saying. I can't remember which one it's in. But it says, after this, he began to teach his disciples that he had to die. What? You gotta be kidding. You know, then we have this get behind me, Peter, you know, get behind me, Satan, and all this kind of stuff. This is the point where he teaches them, okay, you just saw all this, you just heard all this, now you have to realize something. I'm going to die. We're going to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to die. We'll take the Son of Man and put him to death. But Jesus knows this is precisely what has to happen. They don't want to hear it. Again, if you've read any of my stuff or the book, you know that I think all of this is deliberate, because I take Paul seriously, what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2, that had the rulers of this world known, again, what the result would be, they would never have crucified the Lord of glory. They're not idiots. Oh, wait. You mean if we kill Messiah, then we all get destroyed? Okay, let's do that. They're not morons. They know who he is. We know that from the Gospels very clearly. They have a sense of why he's there. You wouldn't send the king unless you're planning to reinstall the kingdom of God. But they have no idea what the plan is. Their solution is, we've got to get rid of this guy. And then Jesus goes up to these two places and says, I'm here, do something about it. Come and get me. A week later is the triumphal entry, and a week after that, he's dead. This is scripted. This is choreographed. He's baiting them because he knows that this is what needs to happen for everything to fall into place. He knows this is the key to their demise. His death, and of course his resurrection, is the key to restoring the nations, getting, you know, believers from all of them into one family, and ultimately having the kingdom of God return to earth. He knows that. You know, again, it's easy to read through the Gospels because they're such a hodgepodge. And the reason, part of the reason they're hodgepodge is that each one has a very specific agenda. You know, there are certain messages the writers want to get across, and so they'll rearrange the material to fit, you know, whatever it is they're trying to communicate to whatever the audience that happens to be. They're all different audiences too. But you take a look at some of these things, and it's like, yeah, that was the plan. That's how it worked. But you don't really see the fullness of it unless you go back to these places and know a little bit about their history and what they're associated with in the mind of the reader and the mind of the writer. And this is just a sampling. You know, I'm sorry we couldn't, you know, go through the whole book, but again, that's why there's the book. So I'm hoping, you know, I know we're going to take Q&A now, but I'm hoping you get a sense that it's kind of important to sort of pull back and try to read scripture not from the perspective of my denomination or my church or my tradition. Read the text. Try, and there are lots of tools, lots of things you can do. You know, you can learn to make part of your thinking. Try to recapture the way an Israelite would have read his Old Testament and the way a first century Jew inheriting all that would have parsed what Jesus is running around doing and saying, what the apostles are saying, how it hooks back into the Old Testament. If you can do that, your Bible will honestly surprise you. There are lots of things to discover that are just not transparent. If I have one gripe, you know, that I just run into all the time, it's that I see Christians, and I get contacted by Christians a lot, and just people interested in scripture. I mean, I don't necessarily know what their faith commitment is or isn't, but they're bored with the Bible. You know, and half of me is like, well, but I know how they can be bored with the Bible. Because I've been there and done that, okay? I understand that, because it's been reduced to a self-help book, or a book about parenting, or biographical sketches, or Sunday school lessons, but now with adult illustrations. Okay, and none of those things are bad, but they're just a fraction of what it is. And if that's all you ever see, week after week after week after week, yeah, I can understand that you get bored. So I'm just trying to encourage you. Take it upon yourself to dig into the text yourself. You can do this. We should take time for Q&A a little bit, I think, while you're figuring out what you want to do. I mean, some of you have heard little snippets of my own little life story here, but when I became a Christian in high school, and when I was nine, because of my parents' work situation, which was in part brought on by divorce when I was five, my brother was three. We spent a lot of time at my grandmother's. Well, next door, there was a lady with four kids, two of them had cystic fibrosis, and she was a single mom, and they struggled mightily. They were Christians. So I got to sit on, you know, family devotions and stuff like that. And I would marvel at my friend who I met, you know, next door to my grandma, who was nine and knew all these Bible characters. He really had a pretty profound knowledge for a nine-year-old. And when I first encountered this, I was nine then, and I didn't know much until I was 16, because I was interested but not interested. You know, I knew who Adam and Eve were. I knew who Jesus was, or you know, I'd heard of him, and Noah. That was the extent of my Bible knowledge. Four characters. Here I am, I have a PhD, I write books, I work for a Bible software company. This doesn't happen overnight, but if you take 5 minutes a day, I was a geek, I'll admit that. I was strange, because once I got into it, I could not let it go. And I was the kid in study hall in high school while the other kids are reading Hot Rod, Sports Illustrated, probably Playboy. In study hall, I'm there with Bible commentary. That's not normal, I understand that. But you just devote a few minutes a day. You, do 365 days. Those are 365 things you do, or you know now, that you didn't know last year. It's cumulative effect. It can be done. And it's fun. I mean, it's just, it's fun to learn the things about scripture that help you understand it more. If you care about it, you ought to want to understand it. So, we'll have more for it. Okay, there you are. So if you want, if anybody has a question, I'll take it. If you don't have a question, then thank you for coming. You can do what you want. Don't feel obligated in any way. And you can ask me anything. Don't think anything's off limits.
So that was going to be my first question, is what's off limits?
Don't ask me about my Naked Bible Fantasy team. How's that?
Okay.
I want to thank you for your presentation. At the church, we were going through Revelation a little while ago, and we got to Revelation 2, where the letters, of course, are addressed to the angelos of the church at so-and-so. We were discussing the different interpretations. And since you were here, we thought we would ask you, or I suggested to them that we should ask you what you thought about what is the angelos. Is it a messenger? Is it an angel? If it's an angel, does it relate to the cosmic geography of a an angel over a location? And I was just curious what your thoughts about that are.
Yeah, it's clear that you have the star language and the spirits of the churches and the angels and all that stuff. So I think that's probably the best way to understand it. I don't think the angel of the church is just the pastor. Although, because the destiny of the believer is glorification, theosis, deification, whatever theological tradition you want, all the traditions have a term for it. I can see that, but I tend to think that the churches collectively, as little groups, are treated like the nations are of the Old Testament. In other words, they have patron angelic beings associated with them. Again, to shepherd them, that sort of thing. So that's actually the view I gravitate toward, but I'm certainly open and try to be inclusive of other possibilities, like the association with the individual leadership. Again, because of the way the ultimate destiny of the believer is described. But that's sort of a hodgepodge, a little nutshell, kind of answer.
Yeah, I'm really interested in this cosmic geography and a lot of things you talked about. Really interesting today. And I've heard, I don't ascribe to it, but I've heard the claim that, because I haven't heard much about Satan so far in your presentations, and I've heard the claim that sort of the concept of Satan actually came out of the exile in Babylon, and that you don't really see Satan really mentioned until some of the later texts. And so I'm kind of interested in what your take is on sort of that claim that Satan is sort of a product of Zoroastrianism.
Yeah, I think that's really an exaggeration. Part of the answer depends on how you're talking about Satan or the Satan figure. And what usually happens is there people will draw attention, and this is certainly the case, where Hasatan, Satan, in the Old Testament is not a proper personal name because of Hebrew grammar. It's prefixed with the article, and even where it's not, Satan without the article never refers to an evil divine being. Even the angel of the Lord is referred to as Satan, because in the incident with Baal, he's opposing Baal. That's just what the term means, to oppose, act in an adversarial way. So they'll notice that, we don't have Satan as this great cosmic enemy. But the reason I say it's overstated is that if you want to attribute that thought, that God has a great cosmic enemy, to the Zoroastrian period, That just isn't the case, because God does have enemies elsewhere in the Old Testament. The Nakash, the serpent in Genesis 3, even though he's never called Satan anywhere in the Hebrew Bible, is certainly an enemy. You know, the gods of the nations are certainly enemies. So it's really a mistaken idea to think that there's no concept of a great spiritual enemy before you hit the Zoroastrian period. That just isn't correct. I don't know any other way to say it. But during the intertestamental period, you get Satan attributed to the Nakash, the serpent of Genesis 3, in intertestamental texts, and of course in the New Testament you get that equation as well. And it's really an issue of the term fits, so let's use it. And nobody's, I mean, I'm not saying there is no cosmic enemy of God in the Old Testament. In fact, I'm specifically not denying that. I think the serpent is the original enemy. It just happens that he's not called Satan in the Old Testament. He is called Satan later. And so if you see that it's that the term is linked to the individual, to the violator, to the rebel, in the intertestamental period, you have to ask yourself a question. Why are they doing this? And to say that the answer is, oh, well, they wouldn't be doing this at all unless they had read Zoroastrian stuff, I think is just ridiculous. And they're doing this because the term fits. The rebel, okay, Genesis 3, the one who caused so many of these problems, is an adversary to what God wants done. And so the term fits, so let's use it. It's just not used in the Old Testament. But it is used again afterwards. And I don't think at all that Jewish writers would have never had the concept had it not been for Zoroastrianism. Again, I don't know how you would ever prove that. And I think it, just on a conceptual level, it's sort of absurd to think in those terms. But that, you know, that's my quick take on it. Is there another question? Right here,
go ahead, do a follow-up. He's letting me do a follow-up.
Just add something. You know, in biblical scholarship, there's this tendency to think thoughts like this. I can't say someone had this thought unless this term I'm focused on is part of their vocabulary. Now, if you think about that, that's just dumb. Because that, apply it to real life. I'm not sure that my wife can think this thought unless she expresses that thought using the vocabulary that I would. Really? Really? Is this the way human communication works? Is this the way human thinking works? That you can't express equal thoughts without using the same vocabulary? It just doesn't reflect reality. But again, scholars, you know, are so fixated on being able to trace everything they say to, you know, somewhere in this text. And they isolate the process of doing that to a specific set of vocabulary. Well, why can't the ideas be communicated in different ways by different authors? Why can't the ideas be communicated through metaphor or through some symbol or something else? The human mind and the human communicative enterprise is not stuck in just this one little, you know, little word that we have to, unless we're using this word, we're not thinking this thought. But yet, scholars just think that way. And it's just not very coherent.
Did you have a follow-up?
Sure. Well, connecting it then to the New Testament, and you have Paul, actually, as you're talking about things, I thought about Paul referencing that the throne of Satan was in Asia Minor, I can't remember quite specifically. And so do you think that Paul actually since thought that, or what was Paul really referencing there?
Do you know what the reference is? We can look it up here.
Oh, you're making me look bad here. No, I can't remember off the top of my head.
Is it throne or seat?
I want to say
let's just try
Revelation 2.
Yeah, ESV is.
Relation.
Let's just do it this way. So we narrow it down. Sure. synagogue of Satan? Is that the one? Or... Oh, I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. 2:13.
Yeah.
This is the message to which church? Aaron knows who this by heart, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Which church is this? Smyrna. Yeah, I can only tell you what I haven't spent a whole lot of time in this. I can only tell you what I've read that in literature outside of the New Testament, that this language, again, is used of this area. So this is John, it's not Paul. So either John is, you know, using familiar terminology associated with this place, which is sort of what I tend to think. In other words, he's not making a specific geographical statement about Satan, as though Satan's dominion was limited, because other New Testament writers are going to refer to Satan in much more cosmic terms. They're not going to isolate him to one specific place. So I tend to be, you know, in the crowd that would say this vocabulary is place specific because of the cultural context in which it occurs. I don't know if that helps at all, but that's where I'm landing on that.
Hey Mike, so I've been kind of meditating on a lot of your stuff in your book since about the middle of September when I got it. And just feeling, I'm sure you feel it, just like a heavy weight of you just want people to know this because it's ultimately the truth. And I don't see a lot of this being preached in church. It's not common in any of like the mainstream theological bigwigs, like even, you know, Tim Keller, good guys like that. They're just not going to places like this. What do you think is a good way of like doing ministry with this stuff right here? Even, you know, do you try to like share it with your church leaders? You just try to go to like people that don't know the gospel yet? Or what's a good way? Because I've even showed this to some people at my church that are like leaders, and they rebuked me and called it heretical. I'm like, you guys just pulled up a website where you thought it told you what this was all about, but like, you need to actually read it. You need to go into it.
Yeah, I mean, and that's part of the reason why, you know, that the book exists and why the book has been endorsed, you know, by well-known, you know, scholars within the, you know, well-known evangelical orbit. You know, I think, I can only tell you what my experience has been. There, you know, unless you're an Old Testament scholar and you've gone through like a secular graduate program, you know, a Semitics program, where this stuff gets thrown in your face from day one, because this is just Hebrew Bible 101. And they just expect you to be familiar with it and know it and understand it. And in my context in Wisconsin, they were very upfront with us. They said, "Look, we don't care that you believe anything or any of this. We just want you to do good work. We want you to do good scholarship." So it wasn't a hostile, you know, environment or anything like that. It just, this is the discipline, this is the field. You need to know the primary texts. One of those is your Hebrew Bible. So unless you've been through that, you really never encounter it. And if you're even in a doctoral program in a seminary in Old Testament, you rarely encounter it unless your professor, again, had to deal with it back in his graduate training. Then you'll get it. And I have friends in the, you know, all the faculties of the major, you know, seminaries that are wealthy. This is elementary stuff to them. But scholars tend to be isolated in their disciplines. Old Testament people think about Old Testament. New Testament people think about New Testament. And part of it is they know they're lucky if they, through the course of their lifetime, are ever able to even keep up with their own little discipline. Nobody's looking to branch out and learn other things. So there's some inherent problems to it. Again, my role, the dirty little secret of the book, is that nothing in the book is original to me. Everything is peer-reviewed, and I give you the breadcrumb trail for everything. I give you more of it on the companion website. I have a bibliography of Divine Counsel's stuff. Everything that's talked about in the book, it's 250 pages long. Okay. I know the literature, and I know where it's out there, but the best I can do is give you the breadcrumb trail. So my role in this is not to be original. My role is to alert people again to the fact that to understand Scripture, you need to understand it in its own terms. And you know, that's significant. It's a significant mental leap, you know, even that, and then to synthesize the material for you. Unseen Realm is an academic book, but it is an introduction in every sense of the word. It is just getting its breath, not death. So that's my little mission. That's again what I perceive my role as, and I understand that people haven't run into it. But here's the kicker. You run into lots of scholars who've run into parts of it. And they read stuff that they are familiar with. And then you can have a conversation with them and say, look, well, this thing that you're familiar with, this actually has a hook into this thing over here. And you may never have really thought about connecting those two dots and then connecting them to this other thing back in the Old Testament. I mean, you essentially build the mosaic for them. But they can't deny portions of the mosaic because they know the field. They know it's there. So that's the one thing that I've found useful personally. You know, when I go to conferences or whatever, run into, you know, friends or people I don't know or whatever that just come up to you out of the blue. And, you know, we'll talk this year, we'll be talking about the book, I'm sure. But, you know, I try to build, you know, some bridges to them and get them over the initial. The initial hurdles are things like divine counsel because they're trained to think that it's polytheism. I'll just give you an anecdote. When I was in grad school, John Feinberg, who was a theology professor at Trinity, published this massive work on the doctrine of God. I went over to a friend's house and he had the book and I flipped through it. The first thing I did was I looked in the back to see if Psalm 82 was referenced. Well, it was. And if you turn to the page, there it is, right in parentheses. No discussion at all. Then I look, is monotheism discussed in the book? Not even in the index. This is like almost 1,000 pages. And I looked at that and I thought, well, here we go, the systematic theologians strike again. Because systematic theologians, they're good people, it's important what they do, they categorize and systematize information, but I'll tell you what they don't do exegesis. They don't do exegesis in the context, you know, of the original languages. They'll throw a Greek or Hebrew word in there when they need to win the argument, but that's about all they do. So you run into that too. People are just not exposed to just primary source stuff in their own fields, you know, the Bible. New Testament dies again. They'll be familiar with Second Temple material. They'll be familiar with, you know, this Pauline stuff. You'll have places that you can talk to them about. But the tougher cases are the systematicians and the philosophical theologians because they will never get anywhere near this. They will have never heard of it at all. Whereas with the others, you know, you can find toeholds that come and sort of talk them in off the ledge, you know, and try to have a reasonable discussion with them to say, look, and I hate to say it this way, but I'm gonna. Sometimes you just need to comfort people. You just need to tell them the truth. Look, I'm not a polytheist. I'm a Trinitarian just like you. I just get there by a different road and for different reasons. And the reason that this road is important because it allows me to not only understand Scripture better, but it allows me to defend the faith in other ways. In other contexts, other questions that you know your road will never take you past. So sometimes you just have to let people know that you're not a wacko, and you know affirm to them you know where you're at in your faith commitment. But then just keep taking them to the text. I mean, there's no silver bullet for this. What I'm hoping with the book is that the book, and we knew it going in. We all of us involved in the project were very clear. On this, we know that the book will be read, and for some people, they will read it and think, where has this been all my life? This is the best thing since sliced bread. And then there'll be other people who hate it with equal passion, and we understand that. But it's not a deterrent in any way. I don't care. I don't know how else to say it. I don't care. I care about the text of Scripture. It's really that simple. I'm not antagonistic to denominations. I can show you letters I get in email. I have letters from just about every denomination under the sun thanking me for the book. And I love those because it is independent of denominational stuff. And I know that. Because it's just the core narrative. It's the core theological ideas without denominational trappings. Because we didn't have denominations back in the biblical period. Surprise, surprise. We didn't have any of that. So, that's what I'm shooting for. That's what I care about. I'm not anti-creator, anti-denomination. If anything, I'm apathetic. It just doesn't matter. Those things are good. They have a place. I use them, like teaching at church or something like that. They're fine, but they are not the Word of God. And sometimes you just have to tell people that. And then when they freak out, you just say, look, I'm here in your church with you because I want to be. Because I believe what you believe. It's just that I'm looking at the text a different way. But I'm coming to the same places that you are. I'm not going to wind up in a different place. But if I took you on my journey, yeah, it would scare you. It's like getting in the car, let's go for a ride to Trinity Land. And a minute down the road, you're going to be in the car thinking, man, why did I get in this car? Is he going to kill me? Am I going to get there alive? You just have to be willing to do that. Just be loving to people, be patient with them, take their abuse, and just, be Jesus to them at the same time while you're trying to help them look at Scripture clearly. This is what you have to do. Anybody else?
I'm going to take a chance to put in a plug for the book myself because that's exactly what it did for me. So if there's anybody here that is interested in that, and if money is an issue, let me know and we'll get you a copy of that. Get you a copy of that book, because I know for myself and anybody, some of us that have read it, it turns the lights on. And some of the reviews, calling it a spiritual game changer in the way that it really just illuminates so much. So if you want a book and you can't afford it, or for whatever reason, or know someone that does, and that's a problem, let me know, and we'll work that out. So, and now I'm going to sneak in a question, if I may.
Yep.
On your blog, you have a description of election, and that's something that really helped me, because election was always just one of these topics that I avoided, like the plague, frankly. Because it just never really made sense. But you break it down in terms of the Old Testament and New Testament, and I wanted to know, would you do that for us?
Yeah, I'll give you the basics of it. I think that election, we'll start in the Old Testament. I think election, specifically in the Old Testament, has been fundamentally misunderstood. And it's not very difficult to demonstrate that to be the case. We think of election, and any discussion that you're going to read about it in the theology book will proof text the concept of election using Old Testament verses. God chose Israel, uses this elective language. And that's very obvious, but have you ever thought about it? Okay, was Israel elect? Of course Israel's elect. Look at these verses. Okay, I would agree. Were the non-Israelites therefore not elect? Well, of course, they have to be not elect because they're not elect. Israel's elect. Okay, I agree. So, how is it, just ask yourself some questions, how is it that the non-elect can be saved, can become followers of Yahweh? Didn't God know was going to be elect and not elect before the foundation of the world? And if he elected some and not others, why are the ones that are not elect? How do they get in? Not only that, the ones that are elect, the Israelites, we had this thing called the exile. the Old Testament. So you have lots and lots of elect people going off and worshiping Baal and other gods. Do we have Baal worshippers in heaven? Am I going to get to heaven and I'm going to meet an Israelite and say, you know, I worshiped Baal for a long time, but I'm sure glad I was elect, because that got me in here, even though I worshiped Baal. That's absurd. That is a theological absurdity. But it arises because we conflate election with salvation. That is not what election is about. It can't be about that, because if it was, you have these internal contradictions that I just named. How do the non-elect get in? How do the elect apostatize and worship other gods and still get in? But there are no Baal worshippers in heaven. So you say, well, what is election about? It's actually not very complicated. Election refers to the act of God choosing a nation, Israel, his portion, his allotted inheritance, Deuteronomy 32:8-9. God chooses them for what? For salvation? Check your ethnicity and you're automatically in. Heaven? No. He chooses them to be the people of all the people on earth who get to know who the true God is. It's to them he gives the law. It's to them he gives, as Paul would say, the oracles of God. They are the only ones that have the correct information about the God of Israel, who is the God of creation and the God of the heavens and the earth. No one else does. Now, they still have to believe it. What does an Old Testament person have to believe to, you know, be saved, to use the modern parlance? They have to believe that Yahweh is the God of gods. We do not worship other gods. We worship the God of gods. And somehow this God of gods has chosen to be in a covenant relationship with us. We have to believe that. And if we believe it, we won't worship other gods. In other words, we'll act like it. And if we're loyal to him, if we have believing loyalty to the God of Israel, we will be with him in the afterlife. It's actually the same way in the New Testament, because Jesus is the God of Israel incarnate. Believing loyalty. You assign your faith, you assign your loyalty to no other. That's just the end of the story, right there. But you have to believe. You don't just get in because of you were born with a certain ethnicity. It's not the point of election. Election is about access to truth that no one else has. Now, in the New Testament, it shifts a little bit, because New Testament election is tied to the New Covenant. In the New Covenant, in Jeremiah 33, different passages of Ezekiel. The New Covenant is again the promise that the Spirit would come and inhabit and dwell the believer to enable them to believe and to, you know, follow the truth of Jesus Christ, you know, on the New Testament side. So the presence of the Spirit and the sealing of the Spirit and the indwelling of the Spirit now, because of the New Covenant, are linked to the idea of election. And election is now circumcision neutral. It has nothing to do with, again, Israel having the oracles of God, because now Israel has produced the Messiah. Now the issue is faith in the God of Israel, believing loyalty to the God of Israel who is incarnate in Christ. And we get that message because, again, of his apostles and other believers. The program, the dispensing of truth is democratized to everyone who has it, and the task is to spread it, and people are led to it by the Spirit. The New Covenant and election are also linked to an Old Testament concept called remnant theology. God will preserve a remnant. That's a nice way of saying God will ensure He has to step into human history. He'll do it to make sure that the Edenic vision never completely dies. Humanity will screw it up at every turn, but I'm going to make sure it never dies. It never goes away. And God gets to the point where he has to send his spirit and become a man himself so that he can fulfill the covenants with Abraham and at Sinai and with David. Because human beings just can't keep these things. I have to keep the terms of my own covenants. And then the key to you coming with me for eternity is to believe that I've done that. And I am the God of Israel in flesh. And so it changes a little bit in the New Testament. I read Romans 8 as meaning what it says. Everyone who ultimately, you know, gets to glory, gets to glorification, well, they were foreknown. They were, you know, predestinated. They were the whole string of events. But those things are not linked to, again, an ethnicity or anything like that. They're linked to the activity of the Spirit, the advance of the gospel, and so on and so forth. So I don't know if I have a label for that. You know, are you a Calvinist or an Arminian? The answer is, the first time I say something that John Calvin would say, people are saying he's a Calvinist. The first time I say something John Calvin wouldn't say, he's an Arminian. I don't care what you call him. I don't care about the labels. I really don't care. I'm not interested in labels. You know, I'm interested in what I can see in the text and, you know, again, trace the rabbit trail down and that sort of thing. You know, I have a different view of predestination that factors into this. I do not believe that foreknowledge necessitates predestination. I think that's crystal clear from 1 Samuel 23 and other passages. For those of you who have never heard that, in 1 Samuel 23, David is, as usual, running from Saul. And Saul hears that David has gone to a city named Keilah. He delivers the city of Keilah from the Philistines, and David helps them out. David's a nice guy. He goes into the city, and then Saul hears, and we're not told how he hears, but we are told that he hears that David has entered the city of Keilah, and Saul thinks to himself, "You numbskull, I have you now," because Keilah has walls. So the narrative says, Saul decides, I'm going to go down and surround the city of Keilah, and David is trapped. So David, we're told, hears that Saul has found out where he's at. And David's a good general. He knows the situation. So he says, hey, bring me the ephod. And the high priest, you know, ephod has the Urim and the Thummim in it. He wants to ask God a question. So the priest brings the ephod, and David asks, will Saul come down to Keilah to get me? God says, yep. Okay, another question. Will the men of Keilah surrender me to Saul? God says, yep. So what does David do? He leaves. Do you realize what the impact is, though? God foreknew two things that never happen. Therefore, foreknowledge of an event does not necessitate the event's predestination, because it never happened. And that simple illustration, again, has profound implications for how we talk about election and things like that. But it seems like nobody notices that. It's very clear. God foreknew those two things that never happened. By definition, his foreknowledge didn't predestinate them. In fact, if I was in a cranky mood, you know, talking to somebody about this, I'd say, especially if they were from a Reformed tradition, I'd say, well, don't the theologians say God knows all things real and possible? That's omniscience. Well, think about the sentence, God knows all things real and possible. Well, if he knows the possible events, they don't happen, they're just possible. Because not every event can happen. Therefore, God's foreknowledge of that possibility didn't necessitate its predestination, did it? No. Again, my thinking on these things, predestination, election, this kind of stuff, I just don't worry about the labels. I don't worry about the systems. I know them, I understand them, they're entertaining, they're fun, because I like to read theology, I get that. But some of the things that are said, frankly, are said only to defend a system. They are said to make the system stand. The system should serve you. You aren't supposed to serve the system. The text trumps the system. Whatever the system is, I can do this on eschatology, it's the whole thing. Enjoy your Bible. don't study it to master a system. Study Scripture because it's Scripture. Not so that you know sort of what bucket to put it in. That's not important. Study it for what it is. I lost track of Will here, he's probably asleep.
Questions?
I had a question about something I think you said in the first hour regarding Genesis 1, 26 and 7, and how that fits a little bit within, you were saying the divine counsel, whereas I've always thought of that as a Trinitarian reading, and then 27 gets into the writer himself speaking in the third person, I suppose, about God. Could you unpack that just a little bit more?
Yeah, I think that, the reason we have both plurals and singulars is because, we already have the sons of God before creation, all that. I think that the plurality language creates a connection between the human beings that God intends to create as his image, and when we get the plurality of the language associated with the imaging, I take that as saying that the imaging that the humans are going to do is the same type of imaging that you guys are doing. Okay. So our image refers to the whole process, the whole program, plan of God doing things and his intelligent beings that he creates doing them with him. Now, we didn't get into it, but part and parcel of representing God means we share his attributes. That's how we get things done. Those things aren't the image, because not all humans possess those attributes to the same degree. You can be incapacitated or whatever. So I think the divine beings share his attributes the way we do. Maybe they have some abilities and properties that are superior to ours. I don't think that certainly is the case in some things, but this is the whole doctrine of communicable attributes, God sharing his attributes with his creatures. So I just take the plurality of language as God speaking to a group. The only group that exists is the heavenly host, and he is saying, this is what I intend to do. I'm going to create humanity. They are going to be created as our image and also as my image. I'm going to create them. They're going to represent me. And they're also going to work with you. I think the language creates a symbiotic relationship between the unseen and the seen worlds, that it connects God's images on both planes of reality. And you could say, well, do we represent them in some way, because of the language? I think, again, the functional language of imaging. I can think of certain circumstances where the language of representation might be appropriate for our relationship to unseen beings. For instance, if the divine council, like in 1 Kings 22 or something like that, participates with God in making a decision about something that happened on earth, well, we sort of carry that out. We are the instruments, we are the tools, we play those roles on behalf of the group that made the decision that how to enact God's decree in 1 Kings 22. So you can talk about imaging that way, but I prefer to think of it again as a symbiotic relationship between the two groups, between the two families. God's spiritual family and his human family.
So you don't think when he's saying, let us make man in our image, our isn't just referring to like Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
Yeah, I don't think it refers to that.
Okay.
I think if you didn't have passages, other divine plurality passages like Psalm 82, Psalm 89, and some of these other ones, if that was the only divine plurality language in the Old Testament, then I think Trinity could work there. But the problem is, since you do have other passages, and to interject or import the Trinity into those would get you into some real deep theological trouble. I think it's best, you know, to not filter the Old Testament through the New, you know, with a full-blown Trinitarian idea, because that's usually what people, you know, do. That's where the Trinitarian language comes up in relation to that verse. They're not doing two powers in heaven stuff. They're saying, well, we're taking this item of theology from the New Testament that we have a pretty good grip on, and we're going to use that as a hermeneutic, you know, back here in chapter 1. Again, if that was the only passage like that, yeah, you know, sure, why not? You know, why not read it like that? I just find it dangerous because of, if I do it there, I could be forced for consistency to do it somewhere else that just isn't going to work for a while. So that's why I hesitate there. Everybody else?
I've been very benefited by it. I have a previous version of the Logos software, and
which one?
What's the current version?
Current six.
It's either going to be 5 or 3. I purchased it about 5 years ago.
It probably looks something like what you saw, right?
Yeah, it looks somewhat similar. I was just wondering if it would be worthwhile to invest in the new version.
The thing that separates the new version from the previous ones are original data sets that we created in the building. And let me just show you a couple of examples here. In terms of the look and feel and your major databases, there's not much of a difference, but if you see like under reference and passage, and not utilities really, but interactive media, these three categories, especially this last one. These aren't books, again, that we're licensing, you know, from other publishers. They are original data sets that were built specifically for version 6. And even if you have similar terminology on your settings menu, there's a lot that's been loaded in there that you won't have. So what I would do if I were you, I would go up to the website and look at some of the new things in the video tutorials or just the marketing videos and decide if it's worth it, you know, to have those data sets. And if it is, then upgrade. If it's not, then you're fine. You can add, you know, anything to your library later on that you want in the way of books. Is that what you were looking for there?
Yeah, and I would encourage anybody if they're looking to go digital with their study, I really enjoy it.
Let me just show you one thing. Here's what will separate Logos from anything else. And I'll tell you how it's done. We have ESV, okay? Let me just get rid of the search so it's not colored here. If I right-click on the word church, you'll see here on the right-hand side, okay, search options, you see this Greek word here? I'm going to click on Ekklesia, and now I'm going to select search this resource. 114 results and 111 verses. We just searched for a Greek lemma using an English word. You don't even have to know the alphabet to do that. That's just one of about 100 functions you can do in this resource, which is a reverse interlinear. We have 6 of them. ESV is one of them. But you can do original language research using an English Bible or through an English Bible, and you don't have to know the original languages at all. Because you'll do the same thing. Just click here, right click, make sure my lemma, the basic form of the word, is selected, I can open a Greek lexicon without ever having to be able to look it up, knowing the Greek alphabet or how to read Greek. Right, there it is. Everything is keyed off and through English, even though it's original language research. Now, the reason that works, because it's contrary to thinking. Well, how could I search for a Greek or Hebrew term using English? That just doesn't make any sense. The reason it works is because the six versions we have of this were involved hand-linking every word of the translation to the original word or word segment of the original language from which that English translation derives. So somebody had to hand-link every word to a Greek or Hebrew or Aramaic segment under the hood. I've done a couple of these. This is one of the things I did in the office. I did the King James with both Testaments. It took me a year. And I'm probably the only person on the planet who has literally been through every word of the King James Version and looking at every segment of the original languages from which it derived. I mean, nobody else in the world has done that. And it's not because I'm great, it's because that's what my boss told me I was doing. Okay, it's that simple. But I actually like that. I like those kind of projects. You know, we created a special tool that you could just click through things real fast. I could do a verse a minute. So about 3 hours of every day for a year, I created the King James Reverse Interlinear. Thought I owed it to the King James because that was kind of what I was weaned on. But the fact that you can do that, there's nothing else like this in any software package, because it's just handwork. And it takes a long time. You gotta pay people to do it. You know, it's expensive.
Okay, I think that's it for questions. Do you wanna give us like a 50,000 foot on tomorrow?
Yeah, if I can find the list of times. Okay, well, here's tomorrow. Lecture 4, the Pagan Christ. And okay, I felt a little sarcastic here. I'll admit. Correlation, causation really aren't the same thing. That is really sort of a brief critique, and I'm only going to land really hard on two or three places, but of the whole zeitgeist thinking that Jesus either never existed. And I'm not going to spend so much time on that because people write on that all the time. I'll mention it, discuss it for a few minutes, but where I'm landing is this idea that Jesus, everything we think about Jesus was derived from some pagan deity, deities from Egypt or something like that. So that's what that one is. 5, Gnostic Christ, Da Vinci Code really is fiction. That's going to be a broad overview of Gnosticism. Gnosticism is something that lots of people talk about, and few people really understand what it is. So we will look at what Gnosticism is and how Gnostic Christians, again, because Gnosticism was a major threat to the early church, how they thought about Jesus, and you know how that's going to bleed into the one that follows, the cinematic or cinematic science fiction theology. Because a lot of the way Gnostics talked about Jesus, which was not the orthodox view of Jesus, has been repackaged and popularized in pop culture, in movies and TV and things like that, and in science fiction. So that's essentially those two. The last two, Genesis 1, 1 through 3, and then the biblical racism thing. The one on Genesis is just explaining how the first three verses of Genesis 1 really are not the domain of young earth creationists. In other words, there are things about those verses that I'm going to show you from Hebrew grammar. And yes, you'll be able to understand it. I've done this at my church, and I use English for illustrations for all of it. But how the first three verses can be understood in more than one way and why. And again, so the young earth creation position doesn't have sort of ownership of the first three verses of Genesis 1. In fact, if you're paying attention to the Hebrew grammar and syntax, it actually presents some problems forgotten Earth creationism, but to be honest, I'll show you, you know, how to work around those too if you're a young earther. But it's just something that people don't realize. People debate Genesis over things like the word Yom, day. That is not where the action is. If you're looking at scholarly conversations about this, nobody cares about Yom, day. That's just too easy. It's really about grammar, what the first three verses are saying and not saying. The last one is I'm going to illustrate the danger of over-literalizing the Bible because of our current racial problems, really modern racial strife, is unfortunately something that grew out of the 19th century, really even before, it was really 17th, 18th, 19th century, in an effort to defend scripture from different discoveries, different scientific theories, and trying to, again, maintain a literalist approach to the Bible that really had disastrous results, unintended consequences, at least for most people in the long run. You can read the abstract there to know what I'm talking about. Basically, you know, after the Age of Discovery, which was the 15th century, people began to ask really obvious questions. Where do these other continents come from? We didn't know there were other continents. You know, like Columbus actually discovered another continent. We thought he went, you know, around the world, probably to the Indies somewhere, and so did he. But it's a whole other continent. They have people there. How do they fit in the Bible? How do they fit in the Table of Nations? You know, you discover in the 19th century is the period of deciphering, you know, hieroglyphics and Akkadian cuneiform. They have alternate chronologies, alternate human histories that extend further back than the biblical stuff. Well, could they be right? Is there a way to harmonize them? Why should we go with this one and not that one? And all these questions that arose during these centuries through the process of discovery, you know, human exploration, and then, you know, certain, you know, scientific theories, you know, factored into this as well. But it's mostly not about science. Science, you know, had to respond to the same questions. It's really about, hey, we have new knowledge about the world and about people and about places that are outside the biblical orbit. What do we do? How do we deal with that? And some people just overly literalized the text to come up with an answer. And the result was something called polygenism. That only certain races had the image of God. Others didn't. There were, you know, pre-Adamic races, co-Adamic races. We can't see the image of God being with the Native Americans or with the Negroes. This doesn't make any sense. Look at them. And people, you know, living in, you know, New Zealand or India or north of the America, we, you know, we don't even know how they got there. So it can't have been from Adam because, you know, Adam's over here. The Middle East is attached to Europe. It's all one continent. They just migrate. They don't know how they got there. So all these questions that were legitimate questions in Western culture led to some disastrous results because people were trying to accommodate scripture to it, or to accommodate it to scripture is probably better way to say it. So we'll talk about that.
Okay, I think that's it.
All right, thank you.